Hi, this is Michael Bloodgood, and you're listening to Wild Man and Steve.
You are about to listen to the intersection of faith, talk, and music. The Wild Man and Steve Show starts right now.
And now, the exciting conclusion of the Wild Man and Steve Show with John Elefante.
The music industry, just curious about that. Secular, you've been involved in the secular music industry, the Christian music industry. We've had artists on, most of the people that we interview are from the classic Christian rock vein. And so I'm just curious what your answer is to this, as we've asked several artists this. Where do you see the Christian music industry heading now?
Boy, I'm not as involved in, I'm involved in Christian music, of course, as you know, but the Christian music industry, I'm not that involved with anymore. I think it's severely shrunk. It seems to have, the only stuff, my wife listens to a Christian station in her car when I'm in her car. She listens to The Message on XM. And I love a lot of those songs, man. They're just anointed. But it seems like it's all stuff that you hear Sunday morning in church. You know, you don't, maybe I need to find a new Christian station where it's a little more upbeat and a little more edgy, you know, a little more disciple, a little more, you know, a little more bride, some stuff like that. But it seems like the most popular stuff now are things that, you know, you sing in church on Sunday morning before the sermon. I got disillusioned with the Christian music business. I thought it was very cutthroat. I mean, it's a business, man.
Yeah.
People are competing against one another, even though we all have the same goal to exalt Christ. It didn't seem like that was always the case. And I was naive enough to think it was. Mm-hmm. When I found out it wasn't, it was kind of disappointed.
Yeah. And I would just echo that. I believe that that is probably the case in many areas, not just in music, but as a minister, I saw that as well. You know, getting into ministry, you know, you're naive and you're thinking that, well, you know, everybody's going to be acting Christian, being whatever. And then it doesn't take you long to realize that not everybody is. But you know, Steve and I have followed and we've seen a lot of the controversy that has been around the Christian music scene. Because we come out of the 80s, of course, where it seemed like, you know, the arena rock era, the Petra era, the Striper era, all of that. It's not the same. And that's why I was asking that question, because it just seems like it's going a different direction now.
It definitely is. The internal workings of a Christian record company, I wouldn't have a clue what's going on now. I only hope it's in bad a condition of this world is in. I only hope the common goal is to exalt Christ, because, man, without that, we're sunk.
Yeah.
Well, absolutely. But, you know, I think, you know, you think back to the early days, right? And I'm talking about the Acts 2 days where, you know, it was a small group and slowly spread throughout the, you know, the Mediterranean world. And then, of course, the entire world. And I think about the stuff with technology, like we were talking about earlier with you in the recording. One of the things that the modern age has allowed is even if your local K-Love is not playing the kind of music that you want to hear, maybe with some of that real heart, real soul, it is out there and it's easier to find because of the internet, whether it's YouTube, Tidal, yeah. Spotify, whatever. And, you know, I've been listening to an incredible album lately, released as a compilation album. It's called Metal for Jesus. And it's done by Christian Lilligren from Narnia and Johannes Janssen, who's part of the Metal Bible Project. And these guys pulled together a bunch of bands and did a compilation album. It's extraordinary. You're not going to hear that on the radio anywhere.
No.
But it is out there. And so I do think technology has helped in that regard. Wild Man, I've got to ask a quick question, though. And I should have done some more research here, and I apologize before we had our guest on. Wasn't John here involved in some band that had a state name? Was it George Thurgood and the Delaware Destroyers, Alabama, the New York Dolls? It was some state name band. What was that?
New Mexico?
New Mexico. It was a band, New Mexico. That's what it was. Yeah. So we got to ask you about Kansas, because we have got a couple of, they're not fans, they are supporters of Wild Man and Steve. Mark and Paul, and Mark Middleberg, who's an apologist and evangelist. And
oh yeah, I've spoken to Mark. Yeah, he's a good guy.
We've had him on the show, and Paul Bradakis is another brother in Christ who is a huge music fan and is a big supporter of the show. So before we do anything else, can you just give a quick shout out to Mark and Paul? We just want to do that to bless those guys. Give them a shout out because they are the biggest Kansas fans I have ever met in my life.
Hey, I'd be glad to. Mark and Paul, I love you guys, man. I see a lot of your posts on Facebook. They're always uplifting and positive. And, man, those guys are the real deal.
Okay, let's go to the phones. Caller, are you there?
Yes, this is Vincent Vaughn up front.
Okay.
Yes, yes, my good man. I found my way today to goethemusic.com.
Yes, great company.
Yes, I know that. They do find exemplary ways of touting their commodity.
Sure, I think...
Anyhow, I was just contemplating a thought today.
Okay, go ahead.
Well, in the old days, people used to laugh at those who still had vinyl records.
Right.
And now vinyl is coming back. I see from looking at this site.
Yeah, vinyl is lately making a strong comeback.
Well, I was just thinking...
Yes, Vincent. What were you thinking?
Well, I was just thinking. My, have the tables turned.
Oh, my.
You see what I did there? Vinyl, tables, turn, tables. too droll.
Enjoy the return of vinyl with ResBand's faithfully restored classics and Disciple, the very first time on vinyl. Go to girdermusic.com today, and don't forget to use the code WildmanAndSteve for 10% off your entire order. Go there today.
You see, my good man, it's a play on words. You know, vinyl records play on turntables and...
Yeah, yes, yeah, I get it. Yeah, thank you for calling, Vincent.
It's just too much.
Yeah, yes, thank you. Thank you.
Neither Wild Man nor I are in Kansas anymore, so you've got to talk to us about Kansas.
Well, I don't know where to start. I will say that when I got the opportunity to join the band, it was what's that old saying when the guy stepped onto the moon? One giant step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Yeah.
Well, that was it wasn't just a step for me; it was a giant leap. You know, that the time that I spent being in Kansas shaped my life. I mean, musically, forever. I mean, it opened doors galore. It opened doors to people that I, you know, got the pleasure of working with. It was a big door opener. It was gigantic. And you got to remember this is, if I could have chose any band in the world that I wanted to join, that would have been the band.
Mm. Wow.
You know, and look what God does. He puts me right in the middle of the band. And I can honestly say that with the, you know, other than the absence of Steve Walsh, I was with all the original guys.
Mm.
Robbie, Kerry, Phil Ehart, Rich Williams, Dave Hope, all the original guys from Kansas, I got to be on stage with, and I got to, you know, do a few, three tours with, and it was awesome.
Mm.
I mean, just that kind of sound coming off a stage is a mind blower, man. Just a mind blower. And you know, every night we do a show, I would, you know, go into one of my favorite songs. I used to love to sing No One Together, and then Kerry wrote that.
The fruits of all our labors have left us as we started. We've come too far to end it in a day. It seems that everything we do is wrong. I want you to know we're all along. Just look around and tell me what you see. Another stupid page of history.
No one together. No one is touching ground.
And boy, it was just, it was a rush. And it's too bad it had to end, man. But it was God's will for it to, you know, last about as long as it did.
Yeah.
Because, you know, because I got to go on to do other things that were, you know, pretty important in the scheme of things for the Lord.
Yeah.
And like, for instance, Vinyl Confessions, it's, I had dinner with Phil Ehart, the drummer. Oh, this is about going back about 7 or 8 years now. And, you know, I've always wanted to tell Phil, I mean, as I got older and more mature, I had always wanted to tell Phil, look, Vinyl Confessions, I sang on two records and then the best of, I said, Vinyl Confessions was probably not the best record Kansas ever made, but in my opinion, the most important record they ever made. Because it was the first time people got to hear a lyric that said, "Till you face the one who rose." They had never written anything like that. And man, did, you know, I mean, Christians were just enamored by that. Hmm. You know, it was a very important record to the kingdom because it had so much great message in it. And I felt really, maybe that's why God chose me to be on that record.
Mm.
And I, like I said, it wasn't the best record Kansas ever made, but it was sure an important one.
To the one who's holding fast, it's a promise that we'll last.
You're part of the dust I am,
but a greater love than man has ever known.
You're part of the dust I am,
and you've got to choose which way you're gonna go.
You're part of the dust I am,
in a world of darkness, come to the light.
Time disappearing, all that you're fearing, dreamers of
know, that's interesting you bring that up, because we have, from following Christian artists, we have quite a few Christian artists that were secular for a while, and then they have a conversion experience, and then they start doing Christian music. But what I'm hearing from you is, and I'm pretty sure you were a believer during that time. Is that right?
Yes, I was.
Yeah. So that's something I think our listeners should hear, is that, you know, that it wasn't the idea that, or even you put your Christianity on a shelf for a while. You were still a believer, and God was using you in that secular vein where you were, which I think is an incredible testimony.
Well, I'll tell you something else. Carrie and Dave and Phil, who, as I knew, the believers in the band, they didn't know I was a Christian when they put me in the band.
Hmm. Oh, wow.
Because they did not make it a criteria that we're going to go out and find a Christian singer. That was not a criteria whatsoever. The record company and the management wouldn't hear of it. So they kept it real neutral. And when I told Carrie on the phone after I got back from a bunch of rehearsals in Atlanta, I said, Carrie, do you know I'm a believer? And he went silent on the phone. I think he started crying. He said that we prayed for that so hard. I just can't believe you're telling me this. And, you know, and Carrie and I are still great friends to this day, you know.
Wild Man knows what's coming here. I mean, you just gave me the eyeball sweats. I mean, to hear that Carrie was saying, you know, we were praying for that.
Yes.
And for God to have brought that. I think whether it's a band, quite honestly, a church, a Christian school, any other organization, pray. You've got an employee spot, right? You've got something in your organization you need to fill. Great. Don't just go out headhunting. Pray about that. Who's the person that God wants in that spot? Who's God going to bring into that organization? And to be praying for that person to be a person of strong relationship with Christ, in addition to whatever competency they need to bring to the organization, if it's, you know, bookkeeping, because you need a bookkeeper in your business, or somebody with musical chops. Absolutely. We tend to focus solely on the competencies, but for that faith aspect as well, pray for that. What, you think God's not going to honor that? Of course he is. Of course he is. And, you know, not only for that group, but in your case also, he gifted you. He's the one who gave you the gifts. So, of course, he wants to see his son go out and use those gifts for him. So, oh, I love that story. I love it.
Well, thank you. I couldn't agree more. I mean, I was definitely used and loving it. You know, before I joined Kansas when I was about 18, I started losing my high range. I didn't have COVID then, but I started losing my high range. I hit that A natural again. It just stopped right there. So I decided to just stop singing and go out and get a vocal teacher, a vocal teacher. And I would take two lessons from him a week, and then I would come home with my little cassette tape and rehearse my lesson 5, 6, 7 days a week, twice a day.
Wow.
And he said, I'm going to teach you how to rebuild your high range, and I'm going to teach you how to do it so it doesn't hurt you when you sing that way. Mm. The reason I'm telling you guys this is because, so 2 years before I joined Kansas, 2.5, 3 years, whatever, there's no way I would have been able to sing. You know how high that stuff is. I mean, Steve Walsh has a high voice, man. And lo and behold, I get 6-7 notes on my range. Now, you tell me that was a coincidence. I needed it to pull off that gig.
Wow. Yeah.
And I think it's kind of still the highlight of what I still do is, you know, having a high range that I could still sing with, you know, even at my age, because a lot of guys, their voices start to diminish because they're singing wrong and they're beating up their voices. It's like they're taking a hammer and just hitting it every, you know, every night for 2 hours.
Yeah, I want to ask, I want to stay on that for a moment, just kind of from a technical side. And we've asked this of a few other vocalists we've had, and different people have different thoughts on this. What would your advice be to someone who's starting out as a singer in terms of vocal coaching? Is that something you would say, not necessarily, but if your voice gets in some trouble, then absolutely go that route? Or would you say, you know what, you need to start off with that right away so that you learn how to do it properly?
I would say just go out and get yourself a vocal tuner and forget about it. No, okay. I'm just kidding. I would definitely recommend that they get some training. And this is why, not so much to become a better singer, but when you're out there on the road and you're having to get up for early flights and you're doing 5 nights a week, 4 nights or whatever, you know, you need sustenance. You got to be able to sing night after night. And that's where the training really comes in handy. Because if you're singing correctly, you're not going to hurt yourself. Yeah, you're going to be fatigued at the end of 5 nights, but you're not going to hurt yourself. You're not going to wake up totally hoarse where you can barely talk, you know, because you've been beating up your voice. So from that, in that respect, yes, I would definitely recommend some training.
So back to the new album, ladies and gentlemen, it's johnelefante.com. You will find the Amazing Grace there. And of course, it's on all streaming platforms as well. What is it, or what was your purpose? You talked about that at the beginning, but let me put it this way. What gap do you think that album fills in our culture today?
Boy. I'd have to place a lot of importance on the record to answer that question.
Important. I think it's a hugely important album.
Well, I in certain people's lives, yeah. Not in everybody's. I mean, at my age, I'm not going to sell 10 million records. But I think in some people's lives, when they hear a song like Stronger, you know, I can move mountains. You know, I'm stronger now because, you know, I got on my feet and said, hey, I'm going to fight this demon and I'm going to get stronger. Mm-hmm. And what I was referring to in that song at the time was, you know, we wanted to put out a positive message and not a negative message in the middle of the pandemic. Mm-hmm. We did not want to just dwell on the negative and, you know, we're all going to die and, yeah, you know, it's whatever. But to answer your question, I think it'll fill that gap in certain people's lives. They'll hook onto a song. That's one line. You know, if I could build the time machine, what would I do to change me? You know, that's, I happen to like that line. I think it's pretty cool because it's pretty honest. You know, if I can go back and change anything, what would I change? Mm-hmm. You know, and there's a lot of people that would answer that by saying, I wish I would have accepted Christ sooner in my life. But anyway, you know, that's a hard question, honestly.
Sure.
Where would you put the album musically? If this is back in the day when we still had record stores, and fortunately there are some record stores still around, and here's the clerk's like, oh, I got this new album in, you know, where are we going to shelve this thing? We're not going to stick it over here in jazz. We're not going to stick it in country. Would you say it's prog?
No, I wouldn't say it's no.
Okay. Where would you classify it?
Well, if there's a classic rock section.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Classic rock, melodic rock. It'd be somewhere in that section if it exists.
Again, as we were talking before, and I was referencing the richness of the sound, both the recording and how clean and sharp it is, but also just the lush layering of instruments along with the vocal. What I think is so neat, I think it has a wider reach because, like you were saying, you know, you might have a singer who's singing something and doesn't maybe even realize it's the Christian lyric. I think you could have people listening to this album and simply digging on it because of the sound. The music is so, you just get lost in it. Several of the songs, I couldn't believe the song was over because I'd just gotten lost in it. And so I think you could have some people who'd really enjoy it just musically. And then as they're basking in that, those lyrics start to resonate and they go, oh yeah, you know, and start to think about it. It comes in a little under the radar that way. So I think you definitely are going to see that people have that kind of reaction.
You know, I found that men hook onto the music right away. Women, and I say this because I know how my wife is, she goes right for the lyric.
Mm.
That's why she doesn't want to hear any of my stuff. The way I write it is I'll write a song. I'll put a dummy melody on it with all kinds of gibberish lyrics. And she never wants to hear it like that. She goes, I don't know what you're saying. I don't want to hear it. I want to wait till you put a lyric on it.
Interesting.
But I try to take people on a journey musically when I write a song.
Hmm.
That's why there's a lot of unexpected things that happen. And, you know, and I try to make it interesting and, you know, I mean, that's just the way I'm wired as a songwriter. I mean, it's just something I like to do. I can think of a lot of records that have kind of influenced me like that, and Kansas is one of them. Yes's 90125 record it's full of just, you know, twists and turns and real cool things happen, you know, vocally, and then, you know, from a technical standpoint. The reverb will just cut out and everything's dry, just dry as a bone. Then the next section's real wet and lush and it sounds like it's being played in a canyon. I mean, I love that. I just love that kind of stuff.
Mm.
You know, so I try to replicate that. Like, you'll hear a lot of that in the song Time Machine.
What are the plans right now? I mean, you know, we always are interested in that, and we get different answers because COVID really closed touring down for a while. And What are your plans as far as promoting this album? Are we going to see some concerts, or what do you see in the future here?
We're kind of in a wait and see mode right now.
Okay.
I'm sure hoping that opportunity comes along. You know, it's if the record gets to the point where it warrants a tour, yeah, I'll do it.
Mm-hmm.
Or even if it's not a tour, just doing one-offs. A lot of bands are doing one-offs as much as they're touring.
Mm.
There's not as much of the 2 month, you know, being out on the road for 2 months anymore as there used to be.
Yeah.
Well, a lot of guys will go out on a Thursday and come back on a Sunday and do, you know, two or three shows, which is kind of what I'm doing right now. But if the record warrants a tour, man, I'm there.
Sure. Yeah. Well, we are too.
Yeah.
We will be there for sure.
Where are you guys at, if you don't mind me asking?
Oh, we're in two different places. I'm in Pennsylvania. He's in Indiana.
Oh, very cool.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but yeah, whenever you're around, we'll definitely go. We'll be in the front row. You'll find one of us.
That would be. I really think that would be such an awesome, awesome concert, and heavily centered around the new album. Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, I appreciate that, guys. I look forward to meeting you sometime.
Sure. Well, we want to thank you for coming on. But before we go, there's one question I have. This is the Wild Man's on the spot question. I always put an artist on the spot. If John Schlitt has talked to you since he was on the show, maybe he mentioned it to you. Maybe he didn't. I don't know. But I always put every guest on the spot. So here you go.
I can't plead the fifth.
Nope. Sorry. It's in the contract. Didn't they give that to you yet?
All right. Fire away.
All right, so here it is. Dead or alive does not matter throughout history, okay? John Elefante's on stage. You can only choose one artist to be up there with you. Who are you choosing?
Oh, boy. Paul McCartney.
Oh.
Ooh. Why is that?
Have you seen the new special that they just put out?
Yeah.
Yes. The three episodes?
Right.
Yeah.
Is that guy talented or what?
Yes.
I mean, he's singing. He's sitting at the piano. I think he was starting to write Long and Winding Road or something. And, I mean, you know, he's such a great – he's a melody maker, man.
And I did not realize that or to that extent until I watched that with my son, who's a huge Beatles fan. You're right. That's extraordinary.
I would say it would have to be McCartney and – secondly, probably Carrie Lucan. Mm-hmm. Oh, I can't give two, though. I'm sorry.
We've learned that artists are used to breaking some of the rules, so we can that's fine. But, yeah, so ladies and gentlemen, you heard it here first on the Wild Man and Steve show that we're going to see a John Elefante, Paul McCartney album next. That's going to be yeah, we'll produce it for you. Steve and I will produce it for you.
Yeah, oh, yeah, that's what you want.
the closest I'll ever get to that is a real good friend of mine. His son is Ryan Tedder, who's in One Republic. And he just a couple of years ago produced a McCartney record.
Oh, okay. Wow.
So I'm looking forward to talking to him about what that experience was like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So see, hey, it still may be there. Still may be in the cards. You know, you on stage with McCartney. There we go.
Oh, I got one more. Ooh, and this one's out of left field. I'd have to say, as a third person, I'd have to go with Jeff Lynne, ELO.
Hmm. Oh, yeah.
Tell us a little bit there. What's the thought there?
Oh gosh, he's such a genius. Just I mean, if you listen to ELO and then what he did with Roy Orbison, what he did with Tom Petty, what he did with George Harrison, what he did with McCartney. I mean, the guy is so brilliant. It's amazing. If you really dig into his whole project of works, he's just absolutely phenomenal. Cool. And from a sonic point of view too, what he does sonically, I mean, he really knows every aspect of being a recording artist, singer, songwriter, I mean, everything. Anyway, didn't mean to stretch that one out too long, but that was a good question. I liked it.
Good. That's more compliment than I ever get from Steve. So I appreciate that.
Thank you. I was getting ready to say, just think about that. Wow, man, we got it on record here. Somebody actually liked something that you did. That was.
Well, we want to thank you for taking the time and coming on the show. And we really appreciate you being here.
Now all has been said, all has been done. You're part of me forever.
It was such an honor to interview John Elefante. The man has accomplished so much as an artist and a producer, and yet he was willing to talk to us and to tell us about his life, his career, his experience, and about his latest work, The Amazing Grace. What an incredible title of an album that is, The Amazing Grace. It is a message that is what Christianity is all about. As John's life explains, it was the grace of God that many need to know about and hear. Serving Jesus truly is amazing. We hope you can share that as well. Thank you for listening, everybody, and we will see you next time.
The Wild Man and Steve Show is now partnering with New Release Today. Find out more about them at newreleasetoday.com. And don't forget to check out our website, where you can also leave us a review at wildmanandsteve.com.
Sounds like rock and roll to me.